Buenos días, muchas gracias por estar aquí. Muchas gracias a Minerva Cuevas y TJ Demos por estar aquí. Voy a hacer una breve introducción de su conversación. Minerva Cuevas es artista fundadora en 1998 de Mejor Vida Corporation y miembro colectivo de Irrational.org. El punto de partida del trabajo de Minerva Cuevas es la investigación de tipo social y político y las intervenciones con texto específicas. Ha generado proyectos que incluyen fundar una corporación que distribuye gratuitamente productos y servicios como credenciales de estudiante y códigos de barras, que reducen el precio de alimentos en los supermercados, así como experimentos culturales planeando conciertos de músicos callejeros y proyectos científicos. Su trabajo ha sido expuesto extensamente en la década pasada. De entre las que destacan serían el Kunsthalle de Basel, Suiza, el Van Abbe Museum de Holanda, la Bienal de Berlín en 2010, entre otras. Quiero también introducir a TJ Demos, quien es escritor y crítico, imparte clases en el Departamento de Historia de Arte de la Universidad, University College of London. También trabaja en su nuevo libro Migrations, Contemporary Art and the Politics of Globalization, se traduciría a Migraciones, Arte Contemporáneo y las Políticas de la Globalización, que explora la relación del video y la fotografía contemporánea con la movilidad y la condición apátrida. Sus ensayos se han publicado en Art Forum, Grey Room, October, Text zur Kunst, entre otros. En el 2007 publicó Los exilios de Marcel Duchamp, libro en el que pone la relación del trabajo del artista con los nacionalismos y trastornos políticos de principios del siglo XX. Durante el 2008 y 2009 coordinó Zones of Conflict, Rethinking Contemporary Art During Global Crisis, una serie de talleres de investigación que se llevaron a cabo en Londres y que también concluyeron una exposición en Nueva York. También el año pasado hizo la exposición conjunto con Alex Fakwarson en el Nottingham Contemporary en Inglaterra, titulada Uneven Geographies. Bueno, demos la bienvenida a ellos dos. Gracias.
Thanks very much, Eduardo. It's a pleasure to be here with Minerva and have this conversation. Thanks, everyone, for coming. We thought that we would divide up the time a little bit so that Minerva will give a bit of some presentation on her work, on her recent work that she's chosen to talk about, and show some images, and then we'll talk about it, and then she'll show some more, and we'll talk about that, and at the end we'll open up the floor for questions. So thanks again for coming, and we'll begin. I think Minerva will tell us about some of her recent work.
Hola, buenos días a todos. Bueno, la selección de imágenes que vamos a ver, las escogí dependiendo de algunos conceptos y cuestiones que me parecía interesante comentar como parte de esta conversación. El primero es juicios morales y juicios de valor. Este ejemplo que estamos viendo es la Bienal de Sydney en Australia y esta obra se llama The Greatness of a Nation, la grandeza de una nación, que es parte de una cita a Gandhi. Ay, sorry. Aquí en Sydney, lo que yo hice fue investigar el contexto político, social y económico del país, de Australia, y me encontré con una situación que tenía que ver con la industria de la piel de canguro en Australia, que en realidad la industria no existe, pero es manejada como una herramienta política, ya que es una de las pocas actividades económicas que tienen los aborígenes para sobrevivir. Entonces, en lugar de estar integrados totalmente a la sociedad y a la economía del país, están segregados también en este sentido. Entonces, lo que sucede es que los políticos usan la industria de la piel de canguro y de este tipo de actividades que pueden hacer los aborígenes para obtener votos políticos. La situación con la caza de canguros no es solamente pues esta herramienta política, sino también a nivel ecológico. Es curioso ver que en Australia, por ejemplo, ven el canguro como una peste. Sí hay muchísimos, pero eso no quiere decir que matarlos o exterminar a una cantidad esté bien. Para producir todas estas pieles, obviamente matan a los canguros más grandes, y los que se continúan reproduciendo son los más pequeños. Los que se reproducen son los más pequeños, entonces obviamente la especie cambia, ¿no? La especie se vuelve más débil, y para las condiciones climáticas de Australia obviamente esto no es una buena situación. Lo que usé aquí fue el esqueleto de un canguro que ya está en extinción. Como parte de la investigación, bueno, también me llevó a saber qué compañías usan esta piel de canguro para producir zapatos deportivos, ¿no? Tenis de fútbol. Esta otra imagen tiene que ver con, bueno, más bien una campaña. Yo estuve investigando también en Noruega, de nuevo el contexto político. Ahí lo que me interesó fue la cantidad de bases nucleares que hay en la zona, especialmente los límites con Rusia. Esto es el norte de Noruega. Y bueno, de ahí llegué a investigar sobre la OTAN. Lo que vemos aquí es un diseño para un cartel, para un mural y en general para la campaña, porque yo me encontré con esta información que tiene que ver con la capacidad que tiene la OTAN para usar armas nucleares en cualquier situación, incluso si algún país no está atacando con armas nucleares, la OTAN tiene todo el derecho, obviamente ellos se otorgan el derecho de usar armas nucleares en cualquier momento, y una de las consecuencias, si llega a suceder esto, es un invierno nuclear que afecta no solamente la zona de guerra, digamos, sino todo el planeta. Este diseño fue distribuido en lugares públicos. Ahí, bueno, curiosamente es el Día Nacional de Noruega, por eso estos chicos traen ahí banderitas. Bueno, estas imágenes las seleccioné porque también nos llevan a hablar de actores políticos muy específicos, ¿no? Está la OTAN, están los gobiernos, está la administración de Estados Unidos, por ejemplo. Esta fotografía me sirvió a mí para acompañar un proyecto que fue un vudú en contra de la administración de Estados Unidos. Lo que yo hice fue buscar gente que supiera hacer este ritual. Y esto básicamente fue porque, bueno, me enteré que el vudú había sido usado como un arma política. Me interesó también la manipulación de películas de Hollywood que lo ponen en paralelo con, no sé, cosas como de zombies y magia negra y toda una como campaña política, ¿no? Para que en lugar de verlo como una religión, lo veamos como una cosa mística, mágica, peligrosa, de películas de terror. Entonces, lo que sucedió fue que se organizó este ritual vudú para maldecir a la administración de los Estados Unidos. Obviamente yo hablé con la gente que iba a realizarlo, que un grupo de gente que se volvió después mi amigo de Ghana, que dan terapia con tambores, etcétera. Su familia es la que hace estos rituales en Ghana. Entonces ellos me ayudaron, obviamente comentando de antemano la situación por la que queríamos realizar esta acción, las razones políticas, y obviamente el motivo principal era revalorar el vudú como esta arma política y volver a hablar del vudú como una religión, ¿no?, tan importante. Y bueno, voy a ir rápido. Bueno, esto nos lleva también a otros gobiernos, nos lleva a nacionalismos, a nuestra posición política. Esta es una pieza que se expuso aquí en el 2007 en una exposición que se llamó La venganza del elefante. Esto es una bandera con chapopote. La serie que hice trabajando estos materiales básicamente comenzó porque estaba yo de viaje en Yucatán y bueno, estaba yo interesada en saber qué había pasado con el meteorito que había destruido a los dinosaurios y cómo había empezado esa investigación. Y lo que supe fue que en realidad esto no fue una investigación arqueológica, sino en realidad se estaba intentando encontrar petróleo en esa zona de Yucatán, y así descubrieron la marca que dejó el meteorito. De ahí pensé que mejor lugar para investigar sobre esto que Ciudad del Carmen, en Campeche, ya que están ahí las plataformas petroleras. Y me puse en contacto con una investigadora del Instituto del Petróleo, y bueno, junto con ella quise ir a encontrar las chapopoteras naturales, porque ella escribió un libro sobre esto, incluso habla de chapopoteras naturales en la Ciudad de México. Me pareció muy interesante, fuimos a buscarlo, no encontramos petróleo, pero sí algunos rastros en la playa. Junté documentación de los mismos trabajadores, bueno, las fotografías que usé, la documentación es de los mismos trabajadores de estas plataformas que después se venden en Ciudad del Carmen como postales, pero en realidad son fotografías tomadas por ellos, porque son los únicos autorizados a acercarse a estas plataformas. Bueno, también hice trabajos en relación al Henequén, que es, bueno, yo creo que antes que el petróleo, la otra gran industria de exportación de México, que generó esclavitud. Y creo que podemos parar un momento aquí para comenzar a discutir un poquito a partir de estas obras.
Okay. okay, so there's There's a lot of material that you've brought up so far, a lot of intersecting connections between disparate geographies from Norway to Australia to Ghana to Haiti to Mexico. You mentioned Gandhian philosophy, you mentioned morality and ecology. So there's a lot to begin to talk about. Maybe we could start with your reference to Gandhi and morality. How does that factor in your work?
To Gandhi and what?
And morality, the moral.
Moral. Yeah, when producing these installations and doing the research, you end up with this problem of being a judge. At some point, you have to filter the information and following your own personal politics, decide what kind of visual information you will use or references you will use. And at some point, including references or judgments to, for example, the Australian government, I ended up wondering if this was not a moral judgment and I was the one deciding what was good and bad, and that was somehow problematic for me. After other works and conversations, I think I ended up realizing that the viewer, the audience, is the final filter. They will as well judge and decide about the visual and the other kind of information in the work.
Mm-hmm. In terms of the engagement of your work, much of it deals with ecological crisis and ecological catastrophe, and I suppose that that's one reason why it directly connects to the theme of the conference, and why more broadly it's increasingly important and crucial today to be thinking about these issues, specifically ecological catastrophe, because we're facing a world that seems to be imploding, that seems to be destroying itself in many different ways, from climate change to the kind of oil industry pollution, to the degradation of the environment that your work deals with. Do you think that creating a moral response in the viewer, is that a strategy to that your artwork mobilizes to try to counter what's going on in relationship to these catastrophes?
No, I think it wouldn't be useful. I don't think it's moral at the end. There are references to very, very specific information, but the example I gave about the oil industry, the whole exhibition, I tried to develop it as a visual essay. So it was not obvious that there was a judgment or anything mm-hmm. around these works. The main or the center of the exhibition was the concept of social ecology by Murray Bookchin. And what I like about that is that about how he develops the concept of ecology is that he never separates the natural environment and the social issues. It's one thing. Ecology is the interaction of all beings in the planet, but he puts a lot of stress on saying, well, it's the social conditions, the ones that are creating not only this social crisis, but also the environmental crisis. And for example, if you take that as a basis, then it's easier to see that, for example, the noise, the pollution, the things that are related to the environmental issues are not the problem. In fact, it's production, the industry, and at the end is capitalism. No, like pollution or these kind of things are only the symptoms, the final manifestation of a, problem. And it's very common to do research, and if you start with an environmental issue, you end up knowing about either social repression or other kind of political issues.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, that's all I think really relevant. Murray Bookchin's theory of social ecology. I'm curious how that connects, though, still to the question of morality and a Gandhian position, mm-hmm. where you could one. I mean, to me, it suggests the development of a personal ethical commitment that can then translate into a political commitment. So it's not something that's necessarily opposed to to politics. And I find it interesting that you cited Gandhi in relationship to morality, and perhaps there's a connection there to the process of decolonization as it existed under Gandhi in terms of the resistance to the British regime. That could also connect as an important prehistory to resistance today to a kind of corporate globalization that I think someone like Murray Bookchin would support, right? Mm-hmm. In terms of connecting ecological activism to a more broad resistance to certain forms of capitalism.
Mm-hmm. Well, at the end, I think that's very much the way I work. Despite I do these very site-specific works, the references and the connections, I think, follow that path. No, it's not only that I'm going to talk about environmental issues, but I'm going to filter it through my references, and those are my references. And of course, probably that's part of my own morality, but doesn't mean that the work becomes a moral judgment, I think.
Right. In terms of that one image that you showed of the gallery with the dinosaur, I'm sorry, the...
kangaroo.
It made me think of dinosaurs, but the kangaroo skeleton. Because that's the suggestion, isn't it, that just as the dinosaurs went extinct, today we face a different kind of threat of massive species extinction in relationship to the ecological crisis, which is part of the catastrophe that we have to confront today. But walking into, if we can imagine walking into that installation, you're faced with this montage of it seems like corporate logos. So maybe you could talk a little bit about how corporate logos and that kind of signage or publicity, that visual publicity factors in your work.
They have been very important as hooks. I mentioned that because, of course, I'm not always interested in the corporation itself, but in the symbol of the corporation. And in some works, what happens with the logo is that it seems that the logo of a specific company has already a positive and negative image as part of the design even. So I've been trying to exploit that more as a code that people has learned and already has in their brains. You know? Like they recognize brands immediately. So when you alter a little bit of information, you create this intellectual exercise, like why, or what are they trying to say, or you try to connect the other pieces of information in the works, but it's very hard without giving a specific example of a logo or an image, because sometimes they refer or they criticize corporate practices, and sometimes they just use the brand as a visual channel. Like, I don't know if you saw the Evian alteration that I transformed into Egalité, this water. I mean, that one, I think it's an example of the use of this alteration using the channel of the brand, the visual information, and not talking about the company. No, it's not always the case.
Wait, and why not talk about the company more specifically? Why not provide that information?
So. I've done that.
Okay.
I think in different contexts, but one example I can mention is the Del Monte Corporation, and what happened with that is that it became, or usually these kind of logos, more than just the manipulation of the image, they became campaigns. So they end up being produced as mural paintings, as objects, as posters, as stickers. No, with the Del Monte Corporation, I used tiny stickers like to put on fruit in the supermarkets, and it's just spreading around, no, in different ways. So yeah, I've done that as well.
That's something else I think that's important to talk about in relation to your work, is that you utilize different spaces of exhibition and dissemination, so that you're working in public spaces as well as in gallery environments. What is behind that decision to do that?
Well, it's not really my decision. I tend to take most of the invitations I get to exhibit or take part of talks like this one. But it's not my decision, but it becomes part of the context, and not only the space, the cultural space where the work is going to be exhibited, but also there is a consideration on who's going to be the audience. I'm going to give an example. Not sure I have that image now. For the Sao Paulo Biennial, the context of Brazil, the social context, was, of course, super complex and interesting. And I had a chance to do something either in the public space, outdoors, or in the exhibition space. But the Sao Paulo Biennial has, I think, a million visitors on average. And of course, it became more important and a better strategy to exhibit inside the museum space and use it as a more public space than trying to do something outside on the streets and that it gets lost or something that tends to happen with things if are not long-term projects. I mean, it's very ephemeral.
Another point in relationship to this question of ethics reminds me of something that Murray Bookchin writes about in his work on social ecology, and that is that he thinks that that ultimately resistance to the ecological crisis that we confront can't be satisfied simply by an ethical or moral stance, right? It has to somehow, people have to be agents within larger and connect to larger social movements, right? That's something that he's pretty explicit
about. And more than social movement, it's capitalism. I mean, the root of the problem is the system. The system basically creates this crisis. And we are seeing it little by little, but
what else can I say? But is there a connection between your practice and an engagement with a larger framework of working within social movements, where art can connect to a broader political struggle?
Well, that's... In my case, it's, I think, very simple. I just project, probably, my political direction or perdón, estoy un poco lenta en la mañana.
I understood that.
Well, yeah. The thing is, well, I take as a basis that the system is creating these problems, and I take myself as a political actor. And if I were a lawyer or if I were a doctor, I would have the same kind of motivations behind me, political motivations, and towards my work or projects or activities. So in the case of the projects, of course, they reflect these kind of influences, because even I was reading recently a quote by Albert Einstein. He said the same, that the social problems were very much part of the capitalist economy, and I mean, he was analyzing it through other filters of information, but he ended up somehow reaching the same conclusion.
Maybe you should talk, present a little bit more work and we can continue the conversation.
Bueno, este cartel está en lituano. Fue parte de la exhibición que presenté en la Galería Curimán Souto. Aquí la frase, la cita, habla sobre el concepto de democracia y, bueno, básicamente dice que es violento cuando un hombre impone su voluntad sobre muchos hombres, lo cual sería como una dictadura, una situación autoritaria, pero que también es igualmente violento y agresivo cuando muchos hombres imponen su voluntad sobre un hombre, y eso lo pone en paralelo a la democracia. Y esto me lleva a hablar de algunos conceptos, como el concepto de democracia, que, bueno, básicamente está filtrando la política y las decisiones económicas en el mundo, ¿no? Conceptos como progreso, desarrollo, globalización, infraestructura, empiezan a ser usados, pero parece que pierden el significado, ¿no? El concepto de desarrollo, de progreso, al final parece que significa lo opuesto, ¿no? Es represión, es crisis ambiental o destrucción ambiental. Entonces, creo que es interesante analizar cómo, como parte del discurso político, se están manejando estos términos y lo que realmente significan o ocultan también, ¿no? Como parte de analizar estos conceptos, obviamente, pues llego al concepto de sociedad, que es la sociedad, y esta pieza se llama Social Entomology, entomología social. En ella lo que vemos son, básicamente pequeñas muestras de microscopio, que son insectos, están también proyectados con proyectores microscópicos. Hay un audio como parte de la instalación que es un concierto de insectos en el que el sonido de los insectos es, pues, al principio salvaje, disperso, pero llega un momento en el que hay un ritmo del caos, se pasa al orden. De repente suena como un poquito como samba, pero se vuelve a perder y se vuelve a generar este supuesto caos en los sonidos y se vuelve de nuevo salvaje. La instalación en sí pues busca también hablar del individuo y, bueno, casi yo personalmente llego a la conclusión de la imposibilidad del individuo a la hora en la que vemos, pues, que todo está compuesto de sociedades, ¿no? Nosotros somos sociedades de células, hay una sociedad humana, hay distintas sociedades y ecologías en el planeta que al final forman una sola. Los planetas son parte del universo, que es otra sociedad de algún modo, y parece, ¿no?, que es imposible realmente llegar a la idea de individuo, y eso refuerza el concepto de ecología social, ¿no?, de que básicamente todos dependemos de todo, y a la hora de generar situaciones violentas o de explotación, no solamente es hacia el otro, ¿no? Estas situaciones se regresan, y creo que es pues lo que está pasando con la crisis política y social y ecológica, que es solo una. Y creo que está bien si nos quedamos ahí y seguimos comentando un poquito.
Okay, maybe you could tell us a little bit about what's on the table in the installation.
Ah, I forgot about that. These books, they include very early drawings, illustrations, and my collection of very old microscope slides with insect parts. It could be a leg or a wing or an eye, the eye of a spider, for example. And there were some very poetic ones, like the one I had with the dust of a butterfly wing. And it's labeled like that. And for me, it becomes very poetic and also very much a reference to what science meant 100 years ago or even earlier, that as I see it, it was more linked with human curiosity or human knowledge to see more, to know more, and therefore the microscopic images. Because, well, that's also the reason why I use some vintage objects or very early microscopes and slides, because if I use a reference to modern or contemporary science, it would be linked to the industry, you know? All scientific research at the moment is guided by the industry, you know, the profit at the end. And I think that's a very big difference with early science that was, I think, maybe I'm romanticizing it a little bit, but for me, I think it was much more linked to this human curiosity to see and know and understand the world. Hmm.
But isn't, like, a kind of this display, which situation, is it a vitrine, or is it glass, or is it just a table with that you can see the objects?
It's a combination. I mean, the table itself, it's a cell of tables, and some of them are vitrines. There are this early insect illustrations, very unique slides, mainly beautiful books. One illustrated by Covarrubias, magnifying glasses. There is also one part with objects related to the insecticide use and books related to pesticides. And it's not only the, let's say, the nice part of insect societies, but there is a link to this kind of industry, and it's not only because I wanted to refer to insecticides, but of course to this other industry that is the chemical weapons industry that is very much linked to this more common products like insecticides and things you use.
It's interesting that you bring that up, because that's what it makes these kind of displays, which are fascinating. These 18th, 19th century archival displays of species or insects, these archival encyclopedic knowledges, which are, as you say, they are certainly based on human scientific curiosity. But of course, at the same time, they produce specimens, and there's a relation to death even there when nature becomes objectified in the 19th century, and so even then, that kind of curiosity about nature was part of a desire to master it and to dominate it, and you can see the connection, whether it's literal in terms of insecticide, or the gradual historical connection to later corporate industrialization of nature and the kind of crises and potential magnification of death to the level of potential endangerment, mm-hmm. and species extinction. For me, that's what this seems to speak of as well.
Yeah, I end up concluding that the scientific research became very much an example of how man wants to, want to control the anarchic, in different senses. There is one work I did for this same exhibition that was one microscope slide. The work was called Colony, but this slide was of a fossil, Diatomacea, which is this marine fossil. And it was a very special one because it was an arrangement of many of these diatomaceas in the shape of a star or flower. Ornamental. Mm. And that was really, really amazing because it was hundreds of them putting in order and shape just to produce a microscopic ornament. But it was this, I think, this desire also to put some order into what is usually wild. And I think the same happens with the music I produce for the installation here, that it's the usual sound of crickets and bees and flies, and then I somehow filter it through culture, human culture, and put some order, and it becomes musical, and then you recognize it as something human. It's very present, and I think other works are even more specific about this thing you mentioned about the control of science upon animals, or I don't know, even dressing a monkey says a lot, or dressing a dog, or doing those kind of experiments at that moment.
to step back and to consider what, you know, some of the themes that we've been talking about, nature, the objectification of nature, its relationship to death, to species extinction, to ecological crisis, to catastrophe and capitalism. We've discussed this in part in relationship to social ecology. But I'm wondering if there's more, if there's another updated terminology that we could use that's become quite important today in terms of political struggles, which is the way in which disaster itself or catastrophe itself becomes capitalized. And this aspect comes out in books like Naomi Klein's The Shock Doctrine, which talks about disaster capitalism. Is that something that you're interested in, not necessarily in this piece, but more broadly?
Well, yeah, I try to analyze these things following the same kind of line, no? Like, well, the problem is not that we have a environmental problem or a catastrophe. The real problem or crisis is that, well, many people, like in Haiti, for example, were living under very bad conditions, and that's why all this population suffered so much. And well, I'm very skeptic about the these kind of aid campaigns or NGOs organizing around the fashionable or the trend of the news, no? Like, it seems that we start learning geography depending of the new environmental catastrophe or tsunami or, all these places, you end up knowing them because now they are destroyed or something. But I think what I reject a lot is the mediatization of these things and this, I think, very these initiatives that somehow are linked to guilt and doing something for the other, but in that second or in that minute, or giving a liter of water, or donating, some money to something. But I think they keep us denying a little bit the political actor that we are every day in every situation. So, I mean, there are catastrophes all the time, and it seems that we only pay attention to the ones on the news.
In terms of that, I mean, that's an important point because, of course, the way most of us learn about catastrophe is through the media, and the media clearly thrives on catastrophe because it increases the ratings, it increases the viewership, right? It creates a situation where we're all glued to the television or to the internet. Mm. And in terms of that, in terms of your commitment to artistic practice, is that not also a commitment to a space outside of that very mediatized, spectacularized relationship to catastrophe? And if so, what is, how can you describe, I mean, you have been describing it, but maybe you could say a little bit more about what the realm of artistic practice offers as a space apart from the media.
Yeah, well, I think that when you do research and when you are close to social issues, information, or social activism, somehow you are kind of, you have like a shield towards that kind of information, no? It doesn't sound like information. It sounds like, okay, they are just mediatizing something and creating a TV show out of something. But I think it's that the everyday practice of politics and being informed what at the end keep you with the feet on earth and Yeah, feet on the ground.
Do you want to present some more work?
Yeah, I think we should continue because the time is...
And then maybe we can open it up to the audience.
Nope. I'll go... Wow. This is getting crazy. I wanted to talk also about borders and the concept of nations and... Oof, sorry for this. It became, it's catastrophe, my slideshow. Well, this is Texas. This is a work I did last year. And I was invited to go to Marfa and produce a work in the area of the Texas and Mexico border. Here what you see is the landscape of around the Rio Bravo River. I went there with a group of helpers that helped me to produce two works. I'll talk about one. Thinking about the border, I wanted to consider the possibility of building a bridge. More than a physical one, I was interested in the idea of a conceptual bridge, or even using technology like mobile phones to connect both countries, because if you are in the border, sometimes you get the Mexican network or the AT&T from the US, and depending of where you point the mobile phone. Well, I started wondering about that. I also started thinking about the idea of walking as a political act. I mean, of course, thinking about demonstrations and marches and all these things, but also in that region, it seems that walking from south to north is the most political act you can do. And, well, with this idea of building a bridge, I thought about probably just creating an accident so there is a connection to cross the Rio Bravo River between Mexico and the US, but then ended up finding this area that is very wide, but that has these rocks, and the final action, was to, crazy. To paint the stones or the rocks I could use to hop from one to the other. So I was marking them with this limestone, and I created this dotted line, and at the end, the idea of bridge was complete. No, it was, using a signal, una señalización del camino a seguir. While doing the marks, of course, I ended up crossing from the US to Mexico and back. And what was important for me at that moment was to realize that there was no border, that all the fears connected or all this mediatized information also connected to US and Mexico border was very much part of a political imaginary that you had to take with you to that area to feel afraid of crossing. Because there, in that specific area, there was no sign saying, hey, you are crossing or do not cross or anything like that. There is, of course, a lot of border patrol presence on the roads, but the Chihuahuan desert is huge. It's amazing. You realize, well, it's that you are in the planet. It's really liberating to cross the Rio Bravo in that sense. Like, you end up realizing, okay, it's impossible to create a real border between countries. And after that, I learned that one of the consequences of building a wall, for example, between countries or between the U.S. and Mexico, the political consequences are minimal if you compare it with the environmental consequences, because some species that migrate from the U.S. to Mexico would stop doing that, and then the specific species of animal would change and eventually die or get extinct by doing that. So yeah, it's really liberating, and was a very, very good experience last year. He wanted me to propose something that could have impact or real results, and I said no, it's impossible. And I explained the reasons why I thought that an art project wouldn't or couldn't do anything related to a problem like that one. They insisted. They said that that kind of criticism was what they were looking for, and that I could have knew about that kind of possibility, you know, decomposing plastic bags that, well, instead of taking 400 years to decompose, 4,000 years, it could take 3 months or something. Mm. So it was very interesting for me to create an experiment around that. And I end up collaborating with the National University, a geologist and a chemist, to try to find the Mexican bacteria that could decompose this kind of plastic much faster. And well, we ended up going to the landfills, and well, being there, I realized I was standing on tons and tons, and yeah, it was a universe of garbage. I think.
Where is the landfill?
Bordo Poniente. It's in the east of Mexico City. It's almost the. It's the periphery. It's very near the Estado de México state. And being there, I realized, okay, this is what capitalism means. Somehow, this texture and abstraction made it clear that all this waste is what we are producing, and the feeling of being there with people that lives there and eats from the garbage was like being in a different planet. No, it was, if this is the third world, that was like the sixth world or something. Really impressive.
And so your work consisted of photographs, or was it there was an installation?
Well, after we did all these experiments, we found some bacteria friends that working together could accelerate the composition of plastic bags. And well, these are just images of the lab and the experiments we did. Some bacteria there. And this is the installation. This is somehow the public result of that. It was interesting to find that many green and yellow green or blue green plastic pieces or plastic bags in the garbage. And I think it's because the green color takes longer to fade with the sun. So it was a very predominant color around the landfill.
We've been given a note saying we have to ask for questions now.
Yep.
So shall we try to transition to questions? Does anyone have any questions for Minerva?
No, for both.
Or for me. There's a mic that should be coming around. So if you have a question, please wait for the mic.
Disculpa que haga Minerva unas preguntas muy básicas. ¿Alguna vez instalaste más de una vez tus instalaciones? No solamente en el lugar inicial específico pensado. Y esta pregunta va junto con otra. ¿Quién toma las fotos de tus acciones y procesos que estás usando como documentación? 3, tú haces la dirección museográfica de tus instalaciones en cada lugar, ¿y qué peso tienen en la presentación estética de tu trabajo?
Bueno, es muy raro que yo exponga el mismo proyecto en dos lugares distintos, porque generalmente son contexto específico y comúnmente me invitan a desarrollar nuevos proyectos. La segunda pregunta era, ¿quién toma las fotos? Generalmente yo tomo mi propia documentación y además los museos que hospedan las exposiciones toman su propia documentación. 3, la parte visual de la obra, creo que es fundamental para mí mantener los proyectos como un ejercicio estético. Bueno, de hecho yo siento que mi trabajo en sí no es la instalación, sino toda la investigación que está detrás y toda esta, bueno, el ejercicio intelectual también que se genera con todas estas pistas o referencias que se incluyen en las exposiciones. Creo que al final la parte visual, la solución formal, es la entrada, ¿no? Es el modo de poder provocar este ejercicio intelectual y todas estas preguntas y filtrar cada trabajo con nuestros propios filtros conceptuales y políticos. Pero es básico, ¿no? que el trabajo tenga esta solución formal óptima. No me acuerdo si había otra cosa por ahí.
No, pero la agrego. Quisiera saber, cuando vendes, ¿qué vendes?
Bueno, algunos museos han comprado obra mía y lo que se vende es la instalación, en la mayoría de los casos. No sé si eso responde.
Claro, cuando vendes una instalación, eso implica el derecho o posibilidad de reinstalarla. A eso sí me refería antes.
Sí, 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 lo cual es, pues creo que una parte muy importante del tipo de trabajo que yo produzco, porque el mantenerlo como una obra de arte pública es muy importante, ¿no? Que tenga como las condiciones de storage, de almacenaje adecuadas, que pueda ser instalada de nuevo y ser pública, es, pues creo que un privilegio, ¿no? Es muy importante.
Sí, aquí. Acá en medio. Hola, buenos días. Nada más quería saber si, no sé, estamos aquí en la mañana, un sábado, creo que estamos interesados en ver cómo la industria de la creatividad y de la comunicación, que es el arte también, ¿sientes que enfrentando la catástrofe es más bien un trabajo de señalización de la crítica hacia un sistema, o más bien crear nuevas ecologías, algo más que realmente mueva hacia adelante? O sea, nosotros somos la idea de transformación, más bien que una cosa de periodismo de crítica. No sé si va por ahí. El compromiso ético.
Bueno, yo soy bastante pesimista al respecto. Creo que mi posición en realidad ante la vida es casi como, bueno, mi ética personal. No sé, creo que sería muy aburrido estar intentando decirle a la gente cómo tiene que vivir, ¿no? No soy nadie que pueda hacer eso, ni quiero hacer eso, ni puedo hacer nada en ese sentido. Pero creo que sí, defendiendo el modo en el que queremos vivir y siendo consecuentes con nuestra posición de actores políticos, pues básicamente ya haces que el entorno personal se transforme, ¿no? Entonces, si cada quien pone un poco de su propia resistencia, ¿no?, ante la comodidad del capitalismo o de los favores del capitalismo, creo que puede ser un modo de actuar, ¿no? Pero sí, no es señalización o crítica tal cual. Creo que sí hay elementos en el que hago referencias, hay elementos en el que ejerzo una crítica que pasa por mi filtro personal de otras referencias, pero al final es simplemente eso, ¿no? Como ejercer mi profesión desde mi política y mi ética.
Tenemos espacio solo para una pregunta más.
Bueno, Minerva, yo quería preguntarte, ¿alguna vez tus referencias o tu juicio político lo pones a juicio?
Claro que sí, todo el tiempo, y creo que justo por eso comencé a pensar en estos conceptos de moral, del concepto de progreso, el concepto de desarrollo. Y bueno, para dar otro ejemplo, en una pieza que estoy produciendo casi permanentemente, que es un video que se llama Disidencia, es un registro de situaciones que tienen que ver con resistencia o oposición o proyectos de vida alternativos en la Ciudad de México. Entonces, ese proyecto se vuelve una cartografía de estar grabando escenas que van desde lo más obviamente político, como las manifestaciones, las marchas de todos los días, hasta la documentación también de proyectos culturales o económicos, ¿no? Como dinero alternativo o espacios de conciertos underground, este tipo de cosas. Pero a la hora de desarrollar el proyecto también me encontré con el dilema y el problema de, bueno, voy a ser yo la que va a decidir qué es disidente y qué no, qué es la resistencia o qué está suficientemente a la izquierda y qué no, cómo va a funcionar eso. Y por supuesto me quería yo alejar de una visión de antropólogo, ¿no? Yo no soy nadie yendo a observar cómo suceden estas situaciones, sino que en realidad creo que la idea de registrarlas surgió por sentirme y ser parte de muchas de estas situaciones y comenzar a registrarlas. Entonces, sí, en el proceso existe este filtro siempre, ¿no? Hasta en el momento en el que decides cómo encuadrar una imagen o qué parte del video entra como parte de la edición final. Pero creo que, de nuevo, a la hora de hacerlo público, el filtro final sigue siendo el espectador, ¿no? Va a haber un segundo, digámoslo así, como un segundo juicio en el que la gente cree sus propias opiniones dependiendo de las referencias que tenga y sus filtros políticos. No sé si esté claro.
Bueno, pues muchas gracias a Minerva y a ti,
Jaime. Gracias
por esta oportunidad.